question. Syndra and Morgana banned out this time for Ninjas in Pyjamas. Don't want Hillisang getting his hands on that. Nidalee and Lee Sin also taken away, so Unicorn sticking with the same bands. Why not? A 2-0.
Yeah, it's working for them. Rengar would be the last one if they were to go 3-for-3 with two of those bands targeted at Lulex. And we keep talking about Lulex, and, you know, it is very difficult to keep pointing at the jungler having little to no impact when your solo lanes are losing so hard. I mean, you have to remember that fact.
Oh, they always take that. They're always the first to be blamed in any game.
But at the same token, when you've got a solo lane that is struggling, having an early game jungler that can turn that around, that can have a positive impact, is something you have to consider. With the Swain ban from Ninjas in Pyjamas, I wonder if they're going to go for a first pick Maokai. They banned Swain and Maokai in the previous game, but their first pick this time around. So they may force Chachi into some other weird and wonderful counter pick.
What final ban for Unicorns of Love about to come through? What do they fear? Braum. They are going towards the support. So Voidal being focused. Is it going to be that Maokai first pick? Or will it be something else? Of course, AD carries are out there. Will they try and steal away Tristana? Will they go Kog'Maw? Will they try and first pick any of those?
So this series, Ninjas in Pyjamas have had a lower priority on the AD carries than they have in the past. And I actually like the fact that Braum is taken off the table by the Unicorns of Love, because what it does mean is Voidal has to play Thresh again. Ooh. And if the Unicorns of Love are like, look, we're not afraid of your Thresh, it puts them in a comfortable position.
Well, we talked about Rengar being banned out by the Unicorns of Love. They have got it this time around, along with Maokai in that top lane. Orianna first pick for Alexic in that mid lane. We'll see what Power of Evil has in response.
Gonna test your memory. I don't know why I am, because your memory's fantastic. But the last time I remember Alexic dominating with Orianna was the LCS Roadshow last year in Moscow.
Yep.
And I distinctly remember tearing apart Fnatic, never dying, cutting away with single-digit HP,
just
command
about
protects,
living, yeah,
all throughout the jungle, over and over and over. Alex needs to find that form, needs to go Super Saiyan, and he needs to carry NIP through this next matchup. If Lulex picks Evelynn and his lanes do not go even, 3-0 in favor of Unicorns of Love.
Nami may well get selected here. It has been locked in for Voidal, so forced him to change something. Didn't fancy the Thresh, no, which would have honestly been a strong option for a Kog'Maw out there. But instead, Nami, just as good alongside him. We'll see how it works out. That does, of course, leave Thresh available, and it will be that Thresh Tristana lane, it seems, for UOL.
Yeah, going to decide what they want to lock in a moment or two, but that Nami Kog'Maw is such an obnoxious lane. With the sustain from Nami, the range from the Bioarcane Barrage, and the bonus damage that you're going to get from Tidecaller's Blessing on Nami, it does give you a lot of power to control your lane. I do expect the Unicorns of Love to be under more pressure from Freeze and Voidal whenever they lock in their duo, because I think if Freeze and Voidal have said, we're going to try and win this lane, we're going to play more aggressive, they've got two champions that can most definitely make that happen.
See whether it works out for them. Vardax, as we mentioned, has actually kept toe-for-toe with Freeze. What's impressed me the most, honestly, you know, with the Unicorns' Love, is while they have got ahead early, they've instantly grouped, they've instantly pushed objectives, they've finished the games very quickly. So often we'll see with Challenger teams, it's like they're unsure exactly how to finish.
With LCS teams.
With LCS teams as well, yeah, absolutely, and it's certainly something, but this is a team that is playing without fear. They are a very young team, of course. They are all just ticking over to that 17 years of age if they can get into the LCS. So this is a big stage for them. I wonder if they're just... I mean, absolutely now, they're going to play without complete pressure. Confidence is going to be incredibly high. And NIP, we saw it with Super Hot Crew, how cautious, how scared they were playing against Rocket in that final game. We have a change, though, in picks. And we are going to see Riven from Cabochard in that top lane.
Okay, so NIP have done what the analysts were talking about. They've gone for lanes that are stronger, that are a little bit more bully-centric. And within the European Challenger Series, Riven is considered a counter pick to Maokai. You can argue the merits of it, but it has worked at least two out of the last three times that I've seen it personally. Smitty is smitten with that champion. He will pick Riven into anything possible, and he's one of the loudest players when it comes to that option. So we'll see if NIP can get a strong laning advantage. In theory, if they do, Lulex will then have options to actually gank, as opposed to trying to save a lane. So we'll see. It's going to be very dependent on Cabochard, Alex, and Freeze to get themselves ahead.
See how it works out. Final choice was Ahri up against Alexic in that mid lane. This is the old classic, I think. This is going back to Season 2 World Championships, Ariana versus Io.
Yeah, I think it is. And for the Unicorns of Love, they do have a relatively strong front line with that Maokai and Rengar once he eventually gets there. But the Unicorns are all about singling out targets. They want Rengar and Maokai to dive onto somebody, have them instantly finished off by Tristana and Ahri, and then clean up a fight. If they get caught in a straight-up 5v5, Evelynn, Riven, Orianna are going to be very, very scary. So this time around, it's going to be up to Unicorns of Love to find the right fights, find the right skirmishes, and not fall behind in that laning phase.
Well, they've certainly found the fights in the past. We'll see if they can do it again. The players are getting ready for the third game, so tell us who you think will go home with the win. Send your tweets to @LOLESports with hashtag NIPWin or UOLWin. We'll see just how you voted in a moment. I'm pretty sure I know which way this vote's going to go now, because you guys absolutely will be hopping on that UOL bandwagon, surely.
Yeah, I think so too. 67% of the vote went in favor of the Unicorns of Love, and I can't see why not.
No.
I mean, they have very confident play. You really, really hit the nail on the head that they are super decisive. They group up incredibly early. I mean, in the previous game, they took in about 75% of the inner mid turret's tower damage at the 13th minute. Just from a kill in the mid lane, they got two or three champions and just pushed it down. It's very smart map play from the Unicorns.
Well, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. We are about to get underway. Game 3 starting out. Ninjas in Pajamas have got their hands on Orianna for Aleksic in that mid lane. We'll see if it works out for him. Personally, I am never convinced by Alex outside of an assassin. We'll see if this one does work out. As you mentioned, going back to Moscow, that was a long time ago. The start of the summer split in 2013. When we last saw Alex, of course, he has been playing heavily in the Challenger Series since then.
Yep.
So, of course, may well have pulled out something special. But for me, Power of Evil has been doing some very special things in that mid lane and honestly made Aleksic look average. And we all know, of course, that he is not.
Well, you talked about liking Alex on Assassins. It definitely didn't work for games 1 and 2 this series. So I do like the switch up. I do like the focus on stronger lanes here for NIP. And I think, I do just want to reiterate, it's up to the lanes of NIP to play aggressively and to put UOL on the defensive. The moment the Unicorns are playing defensively, it then allows Lulex to actually play Evelynn the way he wants to. Aggressively, maybe looking for dives, looking to punish UOL. But we'll see how the lanes do.
Slight miscommunication by UOL. Double ward was placed at that red buff. So not exactly on point. We are seeing NIP being fairly aggressive up in this bottom lane. Freeze is pretty happy, giving it the charge of the Red Brigade, but I'm not too sure if it's going to work out for him. Hasn't got too many behind him.
Busy chilling with that backpack in the bushes.
That's it. Got himself a picnic in there. Voidal's in it at the moment.
Throw out some of the dirt and rocks and see if he can put the rest of his team on his back.
So, blue buff start, buddy system, Cabochard's not going to stick around. Lolex will take that one. Gilius, of course, on Rengar. See how that works out for him. Not seen too many successful Rengars in Europe over the last couple of weeks. We'll see whether Gilius has maybe found the formula to work here. Voidal caught out, death sentence straight away. Vardax immediately puts that explosive shot, gets the burn down on him. Freeze does react very well though. Aleksic charmed in the mid lane. Power of Evil taking that at level 1, putting some pressure down, but not really a great deal of damage to start things off.
No, you need to combo multiple spells to really make that charm work, but this is the matchup that I'm the most interested in. Riven versus Maokai. It's, you know, Riven is a champion that was particularly popular towards the end of last year, and even during season 3 Worlds, but look at the damage on Chachi.
Level 1, trying to go in there. Cabochard hits level 2. Chachi did level up, gave him a bit of a burst off hit points, but that's a warning sign already. A Riven can be very dangerous at this early on.
And of course, in the lanes that we are seeing for NIP, there is a lot of poke and a lot of pressure that can come down. Cabochard doing a fairly good start and definitely out-trading Chachi for the time being. We'll see how they carries on.
It's a tricky, tricky trade because there's a lot of minions for Cabochard right now. Could they get themselves first blood this time around? Still no health bot used by Cabochard. Just starting to chug through the first one, has got his second in his pocket. Of course, Garen Starling with that longsword, very aggressive start. Lolex going to pay a visit towards that top there, but Vizicacci, I feel, may well back away before he gets here.
All three lanes for NIP are pushing against the Unicorns of Love's towers. So they finally pick lanes that do work in their favor. The question is, will the tower dive work? Lolex is considering going in. If Chachi takes the bait and goes aggressive onto Cabochard, that's going to be the signal to move in. Remember, there's not a lot of hit points for super tankiness yet. They're going into the tree.
No, a little bit too much. He does manage to get a twisted advance in there. Lolex comes around. Now they might be able to get on towards him. Lolex going deep on this one. Has he got the burn? No, the red buff not enough to take him down. And a simple flash gets him to safety.
Yeah, look how low Lolex went, though. He's down to one tower hit away, basically, from being taken out and losing those double buffs. So flash was secured from the dive onto Chachi. And Gilius actually isn't even going into lane to take that experience and gold because of the teleport, and that answers why. Sylvats are like, what are you doing, buddy?
Yeah, he's been told. Get your hands off my
fire. Mine.
So, bottom lane, Vardags under pressure this time around. Freeze maybe. Let's see if he's brought a big enough bag this time around. Maybe it's a supersized effort because it may well be required. He has got himself a fairly decent CS advantage already. Good Aqua Prism caught out this time around. Vardags taking some serious punishment, but again, not enough to trade back. And good reactions. Power of Evil also under pressure in this mid lane. Oh, lands another charm on Alex Hitch. Manages to get another burst of damage down on towards him. Fairly even between the two, but Lolex is going to pay a visit.
Yeah, there's no ultimate for Power of Evil, so if he does get caught up by some burst, oh, they're going in on Freeze.
Freeze caught out this time, Flay in there. It's going to be a jump. Exhaust on towards Vardags. Is it enough, though? Exhaust on Freeze. He's running away. First blood comes down. Acathion surprise. Will he catch on towards Vardags instead? No, Voidal will catch on towards him. There's the Acathion, but Hillisang maybe had to finish this one off. He's going to have his Flay back off cooldown in a moment. Dodges out the Aqua Prison. Voidal's going to try and run away from this one. Can he get away? He will not. He's going to be one more hit going on him. Will it finish off? The supports are not enough. While that was all happening, of course, Lolex got in the mid lane and Power of Evil did die. So Aleksic finally gets himself a lead.
Two kills in favor of NIP. So Lolex managing to find a gank. And this is Power of Evil just being caught out of position. Straight outplay and a good gank. This time around, the early laning champion of Aleksic was able to make a play. Despite the fact that he wasn't overextended, he punished Power of Evil too deep. And you've seen how much pressure Vardags and Hillisang were under. Because Freeze and Voidal have been in their face the entire time, they felt they needed to go hyper-aggressive to try and counterbalance the lane pressure they were under. They did get a kill, but obviously it was immediately balanced by the Acathion surprise on the side of Freeze.
Cabochard goes back, gets himself a little more health topped off. We did miss, actually, Vizicacci went all in on him, I believe, which is why he got taken so low. Gilius is nearby. I think Lolex will spot him, though. You can see him coming around there, so he's not going to go too deep on that one. He will back off. Vizicacci just went back and got himself a Ruby Crystal, so not really feeling it. Lolex found out. Gilius fancies this one. He's got the help of Power of Evil coming nearby. There's the slow. They catch on towards him. He's in trouble. Charm catches on. Lolex will go down. Who will take the kill? Shockwave comes through. Gilius has got to run from this one. He's going to be going straight headlong in towards Cabochard. They're going to need the rest of the help of the top lane there. Good Bolo on towards Alex Hitch. Will slow him down. He's going to run around instead. He's going to run on the Merry Dance and go in towards their own blue buff and get away safe.
And while all of that was happening, Vardags and Hillisang actually got a kill in the bottom lane. So well played by Gilius and Power of Evil to 2v1 Lolex. And despite the fact Alex Hitch got in range to put that shockwave down, he wasn't able to continue running to get the kill. Cabochard and Chachi, I think, were fighting in the top lane, so there was no support. So this is the first time we're seeing this. That's just Voidal eating a hook. I mean, doesn't get much more simple than that.
Hook, line, and sinker absolutely goes down there. And the Unicorns of Love in complete domination again, honestly. Coming out of this in towards the lane phase, they are starting to look strong. And Instant Pajamas, while having a much stronger start this time around, a little bit more even, still falling behind in goal and slowly falling behind in kills.
Yeah, I'm going to change the wording. Despite having a stronger start, it's not losing the early game quite as hard. They did get some kills. Lolex has tried to make a play in that top lane before, and they did get the flash from Chachi, which is not up, and Chachi's low on mana. But look how everybody's backed off. The minion wave wasn't working with them. And it is a fairly difficult lane to dive. So even on CS across all the lanes, and Hillisang and Vardags definitely playing very confidently, the aggressive play from Hillisang's Thresh is somewhat counterbalancing the potential threat of Harass and Poke from Nami and Cog.
Problem is, it's Tristana that's getting kills. Starting to get going in. If that can speed up his build, if he can get to that Infinity Edge just as quick as the Trinity Force, it will be a problem, of course. Freeze will have a slight advantage for a certain period of time here. Power of Evil wiping out that mid wave, no deal about that one. Easily done, got himself the blue buff, of course, just picked up. Aleksic will try and do the same. At the moment, Alex is taking the Wolves, so that just shows the pressure Alex is under, having to starve away Lolex from that farm to give him some advantage. Gideas, though, he's on the hunt. He's looking for the red buff.
Yeah, he does not have Smite. It'll be available in a few seconds' time. He's going to be going in with his ultimate.
Well, he's going
to
come around the side. Lolex has already taken it. He's stealthed up. Can he get on towards Lolex? Will pounce in there. There's the Bolo. Catches the stun. Death Sentence follows. In comes Vardax. Pounces on. Gets himself his third kill of the game.
That was a flash Death Sentence from Hillisung that connected after the Bolo had rooted him to the ground. Cabochard instantly gets knocked back in this counter pick. He's got damage, but can he win the trade?
Well, I'm not sure this is a fight he wants. Twisted Advance gets on towards him. Sapling comes through. The slow goes down. Cabochard on next to nothing. Vizichachi can just track him along here. Will catch on towards him. Good getaway from Cabochard. Escaped, but that's going to be the dragon for UOL.
Yeah, you have to question the counter pick, so to speak. Previously, we did see that Chachi had already used his ultimate, so did not have it available for the actual full-on duel. The Unicorns of Love completely outplaying Lulix in the jungle. Good vision and good hunting from Gilius on that Rengar. Immediately led to Dragon and seeing Chachi win that trade in the top lane. Now all of a sudden, Unicorns of Love are back in a very similar position to what they were. Look at Bardex freezing the lane. It's not going to last particularly long, because when you last hit with Tristana, you're automatically going to push. But it will buy him a few seconds of extra safety.
Oh, Shockwave use. Aleksic going to be in desperation mode. Charm goes down for Power of Evil, though. Does quickly turn it around. Manages to get a couple of hits with those Foxtails, but just not enough. He will be forced out of lane. So Aleksic starting to build a little advantage, but that is about all.
Yeah, it's nice to see Alex playing more aggressively onto Power of Evil. But trading your Ignite against a Spirit Rush is not the greatest. So if Alex eats a Charm, once Power of Evil returns to this lane, he could be in a little bit of trouble. Chalice of Harmony in Alex's back pocket versus the Fiendish Codex and the Forbidden Idol. So a lot of mana regen and cooldown reduction coming in on the side of Power of Evil. He may be looking to fight now that he's got some more AP and CDR.
If he's going to go Morel Nomicon or just rush straight for a DFG. We'll see how that works out.
Depends on how many kills he gets.
See how confident he's feeling as well. Ping Ward spotted. Kamashard's going to come around for that one. It's a dangerous move because Gilius is nearby. He's popped his ultimate. He's going to stealth on through here. He's got his stun ready and waiting to go. Kamashard senses the danger. Pounces over that wall to safety. Lolex was nearby. Power of Evil was already making his move as well up the river. He will be safe for now.
So Power of Evil is going to clear out that ward, his side of the jungle. Unicorns of Love got a 2,000 gold lead. And I do think we need to double check that bottom lane in a minute or two, see how it's turning out, because Vardags is now evened out that small CS advantage, and he hasn't backed in a particularly long time. 2,600 gold. Needs a couple hundred more before he can actually complete the Infinity Edge. But still, actually, he may have enough. Mathis is the greatest. Portal, Sheets of Hope does go down.
Yeah, it's not going to be followed through. Too close to the tower. Cabochard again, trying to go aggressive. Power of Evil's coming near. Lolex is nearby. Cabochard's going to be careful. He doesn't get drawn into this one. I don't think they've got vision of Power of Evil just yet, but they're going to sense. They know that that mid laner is missing. Lolex, will he get spotted? Cabochard, Twisted Advance goes on towards him. In comes the charm. Cabochard is going to go down very quickly. Lolex may well get caught out here. Spirit Rush comes in, back down towards the bottom lane. Lolex, Voidal going to get locked on. Pounce on. Oh, he jumps into the Aqua Prison. Brilliant play coming out of Voidal there. But Vardax will get himself a fourth kill. Now Freeze is going to get caught out. He's forced away. And Unicorns of Love pick up another two kills.
They are completely outclassing Ninjas in Pajamas. Three games in a row, Unicorns of Love have outplayed their opponents in lane with their jungle ganks and with their decision making. Vardax has definitely got enough money for an Infinity Edge when he decides to back. Tower is going to get secured for Unicorns of Love in that top lane. And truthfully, I don't think there's very much the Ninja's Pajamas can do, because Unicorns of Love are everywhere. They're winning all of their lanes. And for the third game in a row, they have completely controlled the opening stages of the match.
Pressure on. Roaming working for Power of Evil, found his first kill, and returns to the mid lane. Tower did not go down. It was well defended by Gilius, who himself is picking up that red buff and looking to maybe pick something else up. Maybe going to towards Kawashada again. Kawashada went with this Riven pick, obviously tried to counter it in towards this Maokai. They let Maokai through. It was first picked by Unicorns, and so far has worked very, very well. Rod of Ages is almost completed by him. Well, of course, we do see Power of Evil. We'll see which way he's going to step this at the moment. He has got a lot of gold. Ultimate popped. Oh, here we go. Gilius comes around the side, finds Kawashada, immediately backs away from this one. Do they fancy it? He's pretty low on health. They have got the support of Hillisang just off of the side here, but instead he's going to retreat back to the jungle.
Yeah, well, realizing that Lilix is around, Kawashada is around, decided against the engage. It's not a super long cooldown at this stage either, so it will be up again in about a minute and 20 seconds, 30 seconds on the side of Gilius. If you just look at it, two assists, there's a dragon under his belt, there's a tower secured, and he's got a 20-30 CS advantage over Lulex. Gilius has just been significantly more impactful. Three games in a row, Lulex and Evelyn, and I'm not sold on the presence, I'm not sold on any help that he's had for his team lanes.
And we should point out, of course, both of these teams have had jungler changes. Gilius, so far, seems to be the better choice, and certainly fitted very well into Unicorns of Love playstyle, working well for him. Red Invade, possibilities. Unicorns of Love looking to maybe create something again. Another charm lands. Alexis this time using a good shockwave. We'll try and catch on towards it. Power of Evil's going to go down here. Is it enough? The Ignite is running. Has he got enough to try and get out of it? No, he does not. But Alexis instead will go down. Vizzy Chachi comes in and still is an assist for Power of Evil.
And Power of Evil still connected with the charm despite the fact that the command attack and dissonance was going to kill him. He did not miss a skill shot. I think Power of Evil mechanically is fantastic. He does finish the Marilla Nomicon that you were talking about. Now we'll see in the bottom lane. Hillisang gets caught by the wave.
But Vardak sides to sidestep it. He's got that Infinity Edge. Hillisang's going to be the focus. Vardak is going to be careful. Instead, uses that lantern. In comes the teleport. Voidal. Oh, he's cancelled out. That's in the top lane, the mid lane. That's going to get caught out. Vardak does get himself the kill. Kawashada managing to interrupt the teleport from Vizitachi. That was good play by Kawashada because it could have gone a lot worse.
Holy crap. Somebody give Vardak and Hillisang a cookie. Because that play was phenomenal. I'll explain why in a second. Here comes Gilius, he's on the hunt.
He's got the hunt, he's going to go towards Freeze. Hillisang comes around the side, Vardax is there. They're going to pounce on towards Lolex. Gets the stun down on towards him. Lantern thrown out for a little bit of shield safety. But it's Vardax taking a lot of damage. Freeze is going to try and get on towards him. One more hit, is it
so
enough?
Close.
No! Vardax gets away 24 hit points and he's got free. Now Alexic, he's going to focus on Vizicachi running defensive duties. But the rest of Unicorns, they move in, and once again, they clump up so fast as a team and react to everything NIP throw at them.
I cannot get over the level of communication and coordination between the teams. Not only are they playing super strategically and intelligently around the map, but that micromanagement play, with Hillisang getting caught out, the thing that impresses me the most, Hillisang's caught, but instead of Vardax going north up the lane, he actually goes into the middle of the team because there's a call. Teleport's coming in, Lantern's there. And despite the fact that Riven did interrupt Maokai's Lantern, Vardax and Hillisang just completely outplayed a 2v3 and got a kill to walk away with it. I'm completely blown away by that decision making because it is very impressive under such threat.
Hillisang dances around, keeps the dragon aggro away from Gilius for a short period of time. They get themselves the second dragon of the game. Kawashada in the top lane. I don't think he's going to get this tower. I think Vizicachi should be able to get back here just about in time. He strolls on back there. Has got himself a fair chunk of armor as well. Bottom lane, Voidal throws out the wave, but he just gets destroyed by Power of Evil and Vardax combined. Vardax now 5-1. We talked about the big backpack that Freeze has. Now let's talk about Vardak's one that he's managed to steal off him from the last game.
Well, even more impressive, game one, Chachi carries. Going 7-0.
Uh-oh, Alex, run. Alex, run. You're in trouble. Gilius is going to pounce in towards him. Shockwave is pulled. He may get himself a kill here, but it's going to be his own death. Gilius tries to sidestep, does manage to get away. Power of Evil coming behind. Alex Hitch is committed to this one. Charm comes in. Power of Evil gets the kill, and Gilius is home free.
Alex full-on facepalmed. After that, chasing it. That is the ultimate desperation play. Chasing past two towers. And to just go back to the point, game one, Chachi carries going 7-0-5. Game two, Power of Evil goes 100% kill participation Orianna. Game three, Vardax goes, screw you guys, I've got carry pants too. Depending on the game, depending on the play, every member of UOL in terms of their carries has stepped up to control and incapacitate the Ninjas in Pyjamas.
Yeah, it has been tremendous stuff from this young team that's come through the Challenger. And honestly, you know, we heard, Niff talking about it, Alex, it isn't him trying to dive. Great sidestepping, honestly, from Gilius. Read the attack balls, no problem.
Yeah, he's got really good dancing shoes. And that's a flash charm from Power of Evil, once again, under pressure, landing the skill shot. I mean, Power of Evil has landed so many charms whenever we're watching him against Alex. You kind of have to assume it's the weird one when it doesn't connect.
Yeah, you got to question that. But going back, you know, talking about Unicorns of Love, and Niff mentioned on it back in the analysis desk, you know, the challenge, the LCS teams, or the non-LCS teams, I guess you could call them now, because they have to re-qualify to get back in there for next year, are going to be watching this game, and I would avoid Unicorns of Love.
I tell you what, there's a bigger question in my mind. The Unicorns of Love team that we are watching now, yes, they are beating a Ninjas in Pyjamas that I feel may be underperforming as well. Mm. I think individually NIP are not necessarily stepping up. But this is not the same Unicorns of Love that lost to HTK yesterday and that barely scraped through against Gamers 2. I mean, the level of control and the level of individual ability, maybe they're one of these land teams that just thrives under the lights.
If you actually... Hillisang caught out. He is not going to get away from this one, surely. But it's going to be Vardax with one kill. In comes Gilius. Hillisang's still alive. Lonex goes down. That's a double for Vardax. Is it going to be the triple? Pounces on in there. He gets himself the triple. And Hillisang lives.
The Baller Strike managing to root freeze under the tower. Gives them that third kill. We did see a kill into Chachi in the top lane. I think that was a 2-on-1. But that's a very good trade. We'll watch this one out. We do see Power Evil joining the fight late. This looks like Chachi. Oh, that was a good shockwave from Alex.
Yeah.
Prevented Power Evil getting into the team fight quickly enough. And they just run Chachi down.
He missed the charm. There you go. Power of Evil. It does happen. Tried Spirit Rush in and got pulled by the shockwave.
Yeah.
Well, of course, the Unicorns of Love continue to push down this bottom lane. They get themselves another tower. It's now 4-1 in their favor. They have themselves a big gold advantage. Second tower of the game for Ninjas in Pyjamas is finally going down. And this Riven, it's a hard sell, I think, for me, Cabochard, at the moment. Vizichachi has held his own against effectively two people in that top lane for a while, because Lolex has been camping it.
Yeah, Lolex definitely went for multiple ganks, and it didn't equate into control. That's the third game in a row that we've seen Cabochard not really keeping his opponent down. Chachi, despite the pressure in game two as Aurelia, came out ahead in CS. Despite the ganks, has come out ahead in CS and ahead in kills. And now he's got himself a Frozen Heart to help deal with Cabochard. I don't think Cabochard can kill him anymore. Item advantage heavily in favor of UOL. Static Shift, Vamp Scepter, and Eye Edge. I mean, that's a full item ahead of Freeze. Tristana's weak mid game. It's been counterbalanced. Here comes Gilius.
Gilius pounces. Lonex caught. Ooh, he just got wrecked straight away there. Freeze now caught out. The AD carry. He should be able to turn this one back around. Gilius gone a little too far on that one. The rest of his team focus on towards the tower. Alex is taking a quick burst of damage. They will wipe away, but Vardax fancies it. He gets himself the tower down. And Unicorns of Love get yet another objective. So, quick recap before we're talking about Gamers 2. The power that Unicorns of Love had in that game was their team fighting ability. They took it to the late game and they came back every single time. Would you believe they were 11-2 down, of course, in that third match against Gamers 2? But because they had the objective control, they've been to take the dragons and the towers, the team fighting was so strong. Uh-oh, Alex Hitch caught out, he goes down. Shockwave was pulled though, is it enough? Hillisang taking a lot of damage, but again, just strolls on out of there, and it's another tower for the Unicorns.
I absolutely am blown away by the Unicorns of Love objective control. They have not danced around Baron, they've not wasted their time. They have found ways to push minion waves and then push towers. If you look at the side lanes, the top lane was pushing to the inner turret. Unicorns of Love found a kill on Alex, then a tower. If you look at the bottom lane, minion wave is pushing towards inhibitor turret. I wouldn't be surprised to see the Unicorns of Love pushing middle or bottom and then going for an inhibitor turret. It's what they've been doing the last few games.
Well, if body language was anything, the difference between Alex and Power of Evil on those little cameras down the bottom tells you everything. Power of Evil, talking, non-stop communication. Alex has not spoken a word the entire time it's been on him. Unicorns of Love move on to the dragon as they push on this one down. Vardax, he talked about the carry pants. 705 from Busy Snatching Game 1. I think it was like 19 plus kills for Power of Evil in the last game.
So I think.
And now 10-1-1. And I should point out, the whole time, Hillisang has been doing a magnificent job alongside him.
Yeah, I completely agree. The death sentences that Hillisang has let. You know what? Every single skill shot that Unicorns of Love have thrown out has ended up working in their favor. They're landing the stuff that matters, and they're punishing an IP. And I just think that Unicorns of Love are just the superior players. In this series of this day, they've outclassed NIP.
Uh-oh.
So Baron Bates.
Good ward.
There is a ward, yes, and this time does not connect.
Mm-mm. That ward basically saved lives. They've got to be careful, they don't get caught out. They're going to come around the side here. Unicorns of Love could chase on this one. We've seen some flash hooks already thrown out before. Flash is available for Hillisang to light in just a second. But instead, they've been bullied out, and now they could just push straight up the mid lane. They've abandoned this one. Or they could just turn. Will they go Baron? What will they choose? Any objective is theirs. They know that there's a ward they're walking over because they saw it already placed. They're not going to sweep it out. They've got nothing available. Everything's on cooldown. Instead, they're just going to go straight Baron, and NIP have to react.
So they need to be very careful. Unicorns of Love get caught by a multi-man stun from Riven and Shockwave. Gilius, he's jumped in!
He's pounced on towards Voidal. He's caught out. Stun comes in. He gets wrecked straight away. Lolex caught out as well. Death Sentence again landing. Gets blown away by Vardax, literally. Power of Evil also gets himself the kill. DFG didn't even need to be used. Unicorns of Love go back to Baron.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable decisiveness from a challenger level team. Very little NIP can do. This game is going to be 3-0. Unicorns of Love, once they've got Baron, they can just see them. Here's a fight from NIP.
Multi-flashes. Alex Hitch this time catches a good shockwave. Is it enough, though? No, it is not, because the damage is done. Vardax taken so low, but the Baron was stolen.
No, Baron,
not,
kills,
Baron kills.
Yep.
Sorry, on towards Gilius. I was looking at it thinking, hey? But yeah, of course, he got taken down, and nobody from NIP actually managed to hit him.
So actually well played by NIP at the end of the day, because they do prevent Baron from happening. And this is the three man. The Shockwave catches both Power of Evil and Vardax, and that instantly puts them on the back foot. And yeah, unfortunately, Gilius was just 1v1, and you're never going to beat that massive worm. Doesn't matter how prepared you are at this stage in the game. So Baron ends up taking a victim, but it's not another kill to NIP. It's not gold in NIP's pockets. But it's not a Baron on Unicorns of Love, so small victory for NIP.
18-5, 10,000 gold advantage once again for the Unicorns. It's the slowest game they've had so far in this series, 25 minutes, which is
mind-boggling.
Not great for NIP, who, honestly, the curse continues on this stage, it seems. 3-0 the dream, maybe. Not really the 3-0 they were looking at, but it's a nightmare nonetheless.
This will be the sixth time out of 7 appearances on the stage that Ninjas in Pyjamas, with obviously varying players over the last year, have been unable to take
take the bait? Well, Sapling tossed out, so it's going to slow someone if they walk into it.
Yeah, Gilius is jumped in.
Oh, Gilius goes in, pounces on towards him. Alex is destroyed. Didn't get a chance to shockwave or anything there. Cabochard gets knocked out the side there. Freeze is going to get focused on. He's going to get lashed back in there. Busy Chachi all over him. He gets locked up. That's another. It's a double picked up for Power of Evil. Gilius the only man, of course, the first man going in there against an ace. Fantastic stuff by this young Unicorns of Love.
I have no idea how Hillisang managed to land the death sentence on Freeze, but look at this, saves it. After the bubble comes down, Lulek sidesteps, and Freeze threads the needle, dodges it past Voidal, connects on Freeze and prevents him getting away. The rest of Unicorns of Love, despite losing Gilius, clean house, grab themselves the ace. Death timers are still fairly low, so they'll get the inhibitor and back away.
Well, 27 minutes, and they do get another inhibitor, as you mentioned. It's Unicorns of Love in full control. We talked about Gilius, you know, he's had a fantastic impact. You know, while his stats have not looked impressive, Rengar has been banned out, and this is probably the best Rengar we've seen for a while, honestly, here in Europe. Of course, the Koreans, they know exactly what to do on him, but we haven't seen a great deal of advantage. But that's simply down to the kills more than the great vision control or the great minion control.
I feel like Gilius may be one of the lead callers or shot callers in the team, because even when he was playing Jarvan in the previous games, he would peel and team fight very, very quickly. There's very little hesitation when it comes to this particular squad, and I can't recall a single time where they've engaged and you've kind of gone, that was terrible. They've tower dove and you're like, ooh, that was brave, but it's not resulted in absolutely terrible decision making. So anyways, Baron is back up. We'll see if they can appeal in team fight. I think that's going to be the plan. And there goes Gilius.
They're going in again, and Gilius goes in again. And that's another kill. This time around, it's a good shockwave from Alex, but Cabochard is just wrecked in there. Riven simply does not have the hit points to be tanking in there. Lolex kill out. It's a double this time around for Vizitachi. And wow. Another cleanup crew from the Unicorns of Love. They're going to go back in. Baron is started off. Alex and Freeze are still alive. Going to have to be something magical from them to prevent this one.
Yeah, we'll see. I just think NIP were barking up the wrong tree that time round. Got caught out. Hillersang once again escaped from his life. Live. Now they're jumping on Alex.
Baron caught out. Vardax pounces. Alex caught out. He's going to go down. Vardax is a legendary 14-1-8. So many times the Unicorns have just somebody different that can carry a game. 19 assists, by the way, for Hillersang, still yet to die despite being caught short so many times.
Yeah, look how quickly, whoa, we'll get back to this in a second. It looks like Unicorns of Love may be looking for the win. They have super minions in the mid lane. 20 seconds before Alex is up and Baron for regen. Hillersang is barreling down the mid lane with those mobility boots. This is going to be a 5-on-4 for at least the next 12 seconds, and super minions helping them out.
Well, I think the Unicorns have got something to do or something tonight because they are looking to finish this game so strong. 30 minutes gone, and this game is almost over once again as the Unicorns now in the base. Cabochard comes pouncing on him, but it's Lolex caught by another death sentence coming out from Hillersang. Vizitachi tanking all the damage, caught out by the Aqua Prison. Freeze caught out down the bottom there. He gets hooked in by another death sentence. He's pounced on. He goes down. It's another kill for the Unicorns. They are now 30 kills and 6 deaths. Finally, somebody catches, but it's only the passive, and it's the Unicorns of Love with a 3-0 domination over the Ninjas in Pajamas. They will go through to the Spring Promotion Series for the LCS, and I, for one, would not want to pick the Unicorns of Love to face.
Definitely look excited, and rightfully so. There was no doubt who was the better team tonight.
Solid, solid stuff. We have a new celebration that we may well be seeing in the LCS. The Unicorns of Love. What a fantastic name, by the way. I want to give credit to that because that would be a nice name to be casting in the LCS. So, nonetheless, 15-10, by the way, for Vardax in that final game. Another man, another star. It's a team full of carries.
I completely agree. And I do think there's a little bit of an unsung hero in Gilius. I think all of his games, he was very decisive in his initiations and went down his job and went down his Rengar. And the rest of the team just cleaned up. You go to game two, Vardax gets blown up by Alex Itchy. Power of Evil's like, what up? I don't care. He just took everybody out with Orianna. I'm very impressed. And I do think you do need to throw a tiny bit of salt into the victory because NIP were underperforming. No, NIP really didn't show up. So Unicorns of Love played fantastic. And NIP played a little lower than what we would have expected, so the gulf seemed much bigger. But I don't want to take anything away from them. They grouped, they pushed towers, they used Baron effectively. There's very little that you could sit and say, that wasn't very good.
No, that was tremendous stuff. 0-0-22 for Hillersang as well. Big, big performance from him once again. Honestly, for me, Unicorns of Love look dangerous. You know, looking towards H2K, yes, strong team, but got the problems at the moment. But they did manage to beat Unicorns yesterday. We should point that out, 2-1. So it really does give a big problem. SK Prime being the other team. It's a really, really big, big issue. Copenhagen Wolves, Gambit Gaming, they have to choose these opponents. Of course,
whoever
Copenhagen Wolves get no
as well.
Choice. They will find, and then of course, the sixth place playoff, which will be happening next Thursday at Gamescom. So keep your eyes on that one because somebody is slipping into this relegation and it is a dangerous, dangerous relegation zone right now.
That team, whoever places sixth, it'll be Super Hot Crew or whoever loses tomorrow.
Yep.
I think has the most difficult decision because if you look at the series, you go, holy crap, Unicorns of Love. But if you look at yesterday and the day before, you kind of go, are they the same? How does the change happen? What a difficult decision when you have to counter it up and figure it out.
And something to look at, of course, for the Spring Promotion. Ninjas in Pajamas last time were in that Spring Promotion series as a drop-down. They chose the last team that qualified, just as Unicorns of Love.
Yeah.
That was Rocket. They've just managed to sneak on through in towards the playoff bracket, the semi-finals. Could we see Unicorns of Love doing the same thing? Of course, Rocket came through and 3-0'd NIP last time around. They've just been 3-0'd by Unicorns. I would not want to pick the mythical creatures.
No, I sure as hell wouldn't. Because this is one of those times where you look at the skill ceiling and you think, if they perform at that level, who can stop them? I don't want to put words in Niff's mouth, but he did say that this team impressed him, and he was actually saying, I would be a little nervous to face them. If I was in the promotion tournament and this was the team I was fighting against, he's basically like, look, that is a scary prospect. Mm. You compare the objective control and the decision making from the Unicorns of Love in this game to every other Challenger team and Challenger game, and you go, this is just on another level. You can't even put them in the same category, because this is better than even a bunch of the LCS games that we've seen in the summer split.
Not only the team coordination that's impressed me is the champion pool. They have played different champions. Top laner, three different champions, as far as I recall. Three different champions in the mid lane. Fantastic stuff. And the jungler, he's already proven he can switch things up, and he makes it count. He doesn't only just sit and focus one lane, though. He goes in the middle. He goes in the top. He goes down the bottom. In fact, the bottom didn't need it.
Nope.
Bardags, you know, we were questioning him at the start. Can he compete with Freeze and Voidal? It's a big, strong, experienced lane. They did brilliant.
They did, but keep in mind, they did start badly in game three, but that was immediately counterbalanced once Hillsong is just like, no, I'm not having any of this. Mm. Death sentence after death sentence after death sentence, and they simply outplayed Freeze and Voidal. Every single lane went in favor of Unicorns of Love. I think Ninjas in Pajamas, they really need to figure out what's going wrong, because a lot happens every single time the pressure is on. And it is a difficult position to be in.
Yeah, fantastic stuff. Unbelievable scenes, honestly. Unicorns of Love, once again, Ninjas in Pajamas cannot take a victory here on the stage in the LCS Cologne studios.
No, they really can't. But it's all about the Unicorns of Love. I'm very impressed with their play. I think individually they're very talented. Mechanically they're very strong. Strategically they're very strong. I just want to see them against more opponents to see whether this was a one-time event or whether they can continue doing this.
Yeah, fantastic scenes. Ladies and gentlemen, let's go see what the winners have to say. Shox is on stage with the